Hello, everyone, and welcome to our 23rd Global Public Seminar in Comparative and International Education. My name is Maya Changseviani. I'm Associate Professor of Comparative and International Education here at Oxford. These seminars are jointly organized by the Department of Education and St. Edmund Hall at the University of Oxford. Before introducing our wonderful speakers, let me attend to a few administrative points. This webinar, as you might have noticed already when you joined, is being recorded and will be posted online in due course. I will only record the first half of the webinar, the presentation itself. We won't be recording the Q&A. In due course, I will post the recording on a designated YouTube page where you can listen to all the recordings of Global Public Seminars. I would love to ask you to keep yourself muted throughout the webinar if you can. When the webinar ends, when the talk itself ends, I will be inviting you to ask your questions or share your comments. If you want to ask a question or share your comments, please write them out in the chat, in the comments chat function, and I will invite you to ask your question or share your comments based on what I see in the chat function. Now, let me introduce our speakers. I'm delighted to have our two speakers today with us. It's Dr. Alison McKenzie and Dr. Mohamed Owane. Alison is a reader in education. Her research interests are in applied philosophy, particularly epistemic injustice, epistemologies of ignorance, the capabilities approach, and critical disability studies. Alison has researched and written on the inclusion of children with additional support needs in Palestinian context from a child's rights perspective. Alison is also a great colleague. We work together with the Journal of International Journal of Educational Research. Alison serves there as associate editor. Mohamed has recently completed his PhD in inclusion and inclusive education. His research is focused on how different layers of marginalization intersect to further impact people's ability to access education. Mohamed uses participatory action research as method and approach and has engaged in children's rights research in Palestine. Today's talk is titled Giving Epistemic Due to the Educational Experiences of Young Women with Disabilities in Palestine. I will now pass on to our speakers. I think Mohamed is planning to share the slides. Please do that in your own time.
Is it working? It's working. Hi, everybody, and thank you very much for coming. It's a pleasure to be here and to give a little talk about our work in Palestine. Alison is my colleague and used to be my supervisor for more than 5 years, and it has been a pleasure working with her. And this is the focus of our research and our efforts in the past 5 years or so. So our research uses participatory action approach, and it aims at understanding the obstacles facing young women with disabilities and access equal and just education opportunities. Now, you might have came across this phrase before, but this is the social development, UN Social Development Goal number 4, which is quality education, to ensure that all people have access to equal and just education opportunities. And as you will see in this presentation, for young women with disabilities in Palestine, it's not as straightforward as it seems. And the reason for that is because our research considers different layers of marginalization that intersects together. And that social marginalization and gender inequality, which, by the way, is the safer ones to talk about. And this is why the majority of research focused on Palestine would safely and easily speak about social problems and how they impact the Palestinian society. But the one dimension that we tackle is the political reality of Palestine, which is a country that has been living under occupation for more than 75 years. And up until now, it still is an ongoing occupation, annexation, and most recently, reports by Human Rights Watch and Amnesty International, which, by the way, are cited around the world, highly reputed organization, have described Israel as an apartheid state. So, and if you're unfamiliar with the word apartheid, apartheid means is when a regime enforces racial discrimination to ensure that one racial group has dominance over the other. The only example of apartheid that happened in history was apartheid South Africa up until early 1990s. And this is an interesting one. So whenever you hear about Palestine, you may think that it's a country, it is a contested country, and there is some disputes about certain borders. But in reality, the picture on your right is what Palestine actually is. It is groups, communities that are scattered in the West Bank and fully controlled by Israel. And this is why Israel have stood in the UN and have been many times charged with breaking the international law for obvious reasons, because Israel continued to build settlements, Israel continued to annex Palestinian land, and Israel continued to expand on illegally occupied land and territories according to the UN and to international law. And when you think that the reason why I give you this introduction, because for me as a researcher, I feel that it is unfair to speak about Palestine without speaking about the political reality of Palestine. Decontextualizing the lives of young women with disabilities in Palestine from the political context is reductive, is unfair. Because as we all know, young women with disabilities face obstacles everywhere, and it's pretty it's quite reported in literature around the world. The only difference is that adding another layer, which is state that occupies you, continues to annex your land, and enforces all different kind of derogatory practices upon you, just makes it harder for you to achieve any meaningful change and equitable and just access to education. So this is my introduction, and I'll be back with my findings, but I'll hand it now to my colleague and friend and supervisor, Dr. Alison McKenzie, who will give you an overview of the theoretical approach that we used in our study.
And Mohammed, you'll change the slides for me, will you?
Yes, I will.
Because I don't have control over here. Before I begin, thank you all very much for coming to this talk. And thank you to Maya for inviting me and Mohammed to give this presentation. It's an honor to do this. So I won't spend long on this because I think most people enjoy findings more than they enjoy theory. So I will quite quickly skip through epistemic injustice. You may or may not know about this, but this position has been developed by the philosopher Miranda Fricker. It's increasingly influential and widely used now by a lot of thinkers. But I've been using this approach since at least 2016. I teach this on my master's program, and I write using it as well. Now, in the case of Palestine, clearly epistemic injustice can only be one type of injustice that this Palestinians experience. But what I particularly like about this approach is that traditionally, philosophers have not really looked at person-to-person communicative interactions and how they act to deflate or inflate the credibility of the speaker. Mohammed, would you go to the next slide? And so just to summarize why I think that this is very important, it is because conveying knowledge to others is a really important part of our ethical lives. And some of us are very successful at doing that, others are less so, and that's not because of power of language. And how well we communicate what we know and have experienced is largely dependent on whether we get uptake from others, whether other people are willing to listen to us and not discount what we say because we're women or because we're from a discredited or a disadvantaged community. And so the kinds of things that deflate the integrity or the quality of what we say are dependent on things like trust, how silence operates between individuals and groups to silence people, forms of ignorance, which is not an absence of knowledge, is far more insidious than that, how we use the reputation of the speaker to appraise their worth, and often without even being aware of it, how prejudicial stereotypes that we are carrying in our heads inform or allow us to assess the testimony of the speaker. And often these things are, it's not just an individual thing between a person and a person, but they're embedded in systems and structures. So they're very, very deep rooted. Often they are pervasive. And again, if we think of the Palestinian situation and in the conditions that Mohammed has just described, trying to uproot prejudicial stereotypes about Palestinians is extremely difficult. But I don't think that there is a will to uproot those prejudicial stereotypes anyway. So Ficker has identified a succinct definition of what an unjust and epistemic injustice is. And that is the means by which a person is fundamentally and specifically wronged in her capacity as a knower. In other words, what she knows does not matter, or is not going to gain traction, or is the knowledge that she had is not going to be distributed because who she is as a person is of little account. And she describes two types. The testimonial, the person-to-person type of injustice, is when prejudice causes a hearer to give a deflated level of the credibility to a speaker's word. And then hermeneutical, often more often associated with interpretation of scripture originally. And social epistemology means how we interpret or are able to interpret our social experiences. And here, these kinds of injustices occur because of structural injustice, whereby the speaker is at an unfair disadvantage because there are insufficient interpretive resources to make sense of or to intelligibly convey a social experience. And Mohammed will give us examples of that in the case of disabled girls in Palestine whose social experiences are really sought out. And even when they are given the opportunity to speak out, they're not given uptake. And even if Kiwan girls are invited to speak, they really have the interpretive resources to be able to convey what it's like to be a disabled girl in the Palestinian context. And fundamental to the way that these injustices operate is prejudicial stereotypes, negative, particularly negative prejudicial stereotypes. And the definition is there for you. These are unreliable empirical generalizations about the characteristics of some group or person. And we are familiar with many of them as women, children, Black people, LGBTQ+. And in our own context of Northern Ireland and the island of Ireland, the Irish. Okay, Mohammed. And the point about negative prejudicial stereotypes is that they are hard to detect, let alone eradicate. And even when we are conscious of these, that negative identity prejudices influence our perceptions and belief. And hegemonic positions of power, people in power, states that have power over another state, actively promote negative identity prejudices so that it is much easier to discredit their claims, to ignore their claims, or to treat them in ways that treat in some way these marginal identities such that they behave or comply in desired ways. And the other important thing is that these reside in a collective social imagination. And because they're so widespread in the social imagination, once again, they're very, very hard to detect. And even when they are detected, they're hard to eradicate because it depends on the will of the individual and of groups and of societies to work in concert to eradicate the negative identity prejudices. And so there are two types of harm. We've got a primary harm, which is wronging a person in their capacity as a knower. I'm sure we all have experienced what it is like when we try to convey something very, very important and we're not believed. And we're not believed because I'm a woman, I'm from a minority language, I'm from an ethnic group whose religious practices arouse suspicion, and so on and so forth. And what this does is to impede knowledge from entering the public discourse. And those with power have vested interests in ensuring that these primary harms and what people know are not permitted to enter. Okay, Mohammed, the next slide. And there are secondary harms that follow from the primary harm. And these are both practical and epistemic in dimension. And the practical harms include language. When language, so to give an example from my own context, the minority languages of the United Kingdom, Gaelic, Scottish Gaelic, Irish language, have been for centuries discredited, and active attempts to eradicate the language in order for English to gain hegemony, and the languages and the people who speak them treated as uncivilized, labial, alcoholics, and whatever have you. But these kinds of activities and acts also happen in with respect to racial discrimination in the legal profession, for example, in educational contexts. And I'm not talking here about one-off incidents of discrimination, but persistent discrimination. And then in this case, these are the kinds of harms that then feed into the kinds of apartheid structures that we see in Israel today. Mohammed. And finally, Fricker talks about one of the most persistent testimonial injustice is that eventually it can cause the speaker to lose confidence in their beliefs and their justification for those beliefs, and particularly when they're in systems that simply give them no opportunity to convey that knowledge to people who could do something about the situation they're in. And she talks about them literally losing knowledge, and that's where epistemologies of ignorance come in. But I will leave it there and hand it back over to Mohammed.
Thanks very much, Alison, and thanks for the introduction of the approach. So again, it's just a reminder. The whole idea of how it's what's happening in Palestine right now is that you have three layers of marginalization. Those three layers of marginalization feeds into one power structure into another, and they are all skewed power structures. They are in no way, shape, or form are power structures that are based on creating some form of equality between people. And one of them is obviously the one that impacts every Palestinian, regardless of whether they are disabled, abled, men or women, and that is the Israeli occupation and the threat of the ongoing annexation. Now, it impacts people relatively differently, but it impacts everybody, whether it is a fairly educated man coming from a, you know, a fairly stable socioeconomic background like myself, or whether it is a young woman with disability living in a place like Masafer Yatta, it just impacts everybody equally. And then you have the socioeconomic marginalization, which is how deeply rooted stereotypes about gender and ability function within this already skewed and distorted system. So you have a distorted system of unequal power that impacts everybody. And within that system in itself, you have also other social structures that are based on stereotypes, and especially in relation to gender and ability. So for example, if the common thought about people with disability is that they are incapable of doing something, and well, that is a very interesting finding that I got in my research, that we don't have a sort of, or that's what my research participant felt, that people in Palestine don't have sort of a balanced view of people with disabilities. They either think of them as superhumans or as subhumans. So it's either that they are fantastic for doing the things that they do. If they can walk to the grocery shop, then they are fantastic for doing that. But also, they are limited in the way to think of what potential they could achieve. And of course, that is a very demeaning, prejudicial stereotype that impact people with disabilities, especially young girls and their access to education. But to have a similar stereotype functioning within a more and bigger power structure that is imbalanced, you can only imagine how impact that has on the young girls. And to that in a minute, and I'll go to the themes that have emerged from my research. And despite everything that is happening, the theme that was reoccurring all the time is that for the women, their identity are those three, are being Palestinian, are being a woman, and are having a disability, and is having a disability. So they don't try to, they recognize the difficulties associated with each, especially being Palestinian and having a disability. But they come in terms with this idea that this is who we are, and we need to navigate the system according to who we are. And that feeds into the next slide, where I'll describe another. And then the other theme is the difficulties that are faced by young women with disabilities in general. And we are talking about the poor infrastructure and lack of resources, which is, again, it is a context related. You have a country that has a very limited access to infrastructure and resources, all while being under occupation. And then, but the one that they felt the most towards our attitudes, because for them, they thought that infrastructure can change, but attitudes are much, much harder to change. And that also feeds into the idea of epistemic injustice, when something is so deeply rooted within the social imagination, an attitude, a stereotype that is so deeply rooted in social imagination, it's very difficult to change. And then from that, they delve into what made their lives better, what made them flourish, and how they at some point were able to access education. And for the ones who did, it was the family support, the community support, and the government support. And clearly what happened here is a friction in the social imagination among those people, when their families and their communities challenge the stereotypes they've had on a disability to a point where they've supported them to go and get access to education. While the ones they didn't get access to education, they didn't have that kind of support, those circles support did not exist. But the one that is for me is the most interesting one. You know, we all have favorite parts about our research. And for me, my favorite part about my research is the idea of defiance and resilience as a theme emerging. Because, and again, to relate it back to the first point that I've shared, which is being Palestinian, which is how they feel about their identity, is that they see that their identity and the idea of defiance and resilience are connected, they intersect, they are inseparable. To be a Palestinian, and I'm quoting directly from one of my research participants, to be a Palestinian is to be resilient. And that's just part of who we are. We were, they were brought up in these extreme conditions where for them, you know, you have to fight, you have to always go for an extra mile in order to get the things that you need across. And then the idea of the importance of education. Obviously they all see, they all value education, and it is a tool for development and a tool for economic empowerment, economic independency. And for them, that is also important to sort of gain independence economically, so they could function independently from the rest of us, change the stereotype about them being a burden. But what's more important is that they all of the participants have agreed that education is a right. It is inseparable from other human rights, and any human should get access to education. And the final idea here is the epistemology of resistance. And that is a term introduced by José Medina, who is another epistemological philosopher, complemented what Fricker started. And he stresses that in situation of oppression and epistemic relations are substantially affected because inequality is the enemy of knowledge. If you have inequality, you can't have knowledge. And it's simply because it handicaps our capacity to learn from each other. Social injustices breeds epistemic injustices. And these two kinds of injustices are two sides of the same coin. And this brings me back to the first point that I've raised in this presentation. But as long as there are deeply situated injustices that every Palestinian has to endure, epistemic injustice will persist and will continue and will remain. And even if it is difficult to change the social imagination in a fully functioning society, imagine how hard it is. It's even harder where you have a situation of severe inequality like in Palestine. And for Medina, he identified two forms of epistemic vices and epistemic virtues. So epistemic vices of arrogance and laziness and close-mindedness. For him, they are for privileged individuals, because privileged individuals don't have to they don't have to go the extra mile to think. They don't have to challenge the social imagination, because challenging the social imagination would impact their privileged status. However, they do impact a person's ability to learn. And if they are all found together in a subject, and by subject here, I mean a person, I'm directly quoting him, they create what he calls an act of ignorance, which is at that point, a person is becoming culpable of being ignorant, and being ignorant isn't something that can slide off anymore. However, he also identified three virtues. Those are the humility, curiosity, and open-mindedness. And for him, and that's a very interesting point, underprivileged people are more likely to have these three virtues, simply because their knowledge was undermined for too long, where they always doubt what they know, to a point where they always keep referring back to what they know and questioning themselves. And I'm quoting him directly now, if these questioning aren't pathological, then they could be very beneficial for the person. And this is, and for him, you know, that's a very long discussion, but in a very short, for him, it is an adaptive strategy. It is a way for underprivileged subjects to survive. You need to think, you need to have the dual thinking as your master and as your fellow slave. And for him, a person who has that ability, they are meta-lucid person, or they have the meta-lucidity. And it's only then that we can actively challenge the social imagination, which is deeply rooted in our collective social knowledge. Thank you very much. I try to concise everything in the slides, but now the floor is yours. And if you have any questions, we are more than happy to answer.